Hello everyone. In the previous session, I have done a theorem based on zeros of analytical function. So we have mainly three theories, corollaries based on that theorem. So let me do that in this session. So corollary one says that suppose if f of z is analytical in a region D and f dash of z is equal to zero in a neighborhood of a point A in D, then we have to prove that f of z is constant in D. So before going to prove this corollary, let me revise the theorem statement that I have done in a previous session. Theorem says that first one is fn of A is equal to zero for any point A in D and f of z is analytical. And second one says that f of z is equal to zero in neighborhood of D. If that was the case, f of z is equal to 0 in a region D. So these three statements are equivalent, and that is what I have proved in the previous session. Now we have a corollary 1. So here f of z is analytical in a region D and f dash of z, small f dash of z is 0 in a neighborhood of a point A in D. Then we have to prove that f of z is constant. Fine, so small f of z is constant. Now let us take a capital F of z as a difference of this function and its neighborhood. A is a neighborhood of point z. Suppose if I have a complex plane and z is any point and A is neighborhood of this point. So let me define this function f, capital F of z as small f of z minus f of A. We have to prove that this small f of z is constant in region D. Fine. So if f of z is expressed, since f of z is analytical, small f of z is analytical. So if this is analytical, as I already told you, it will be, when do we say function is analytical? If it is differentiable at a point A and its neighborhoods. So fine. So if f of z is analytical, since A is arbitrary, we can say f of A is also analytical and the difference is also analytical. Therefore, if RHS is analytical, we can say LHS is also analytical. Therefore, I can say that f of z is analytical in region D. So, and meaning of analyticality is differentiability. That is, if a function, derivative of a function exists, then we can say a function is analytical. Since I have already proved that f of z is analytical, therefore I can say f dash of z will be equal to f dash of z. Now, in the theorem statement, given that f dash of z is equal to 0. Right. So if the f dash of z is equal to 0, from the when we substitute f dash is z is equal to 0, this equation can be written as capital F dash of z is also equal to 0. If capital F dash of z is 0, I can say capital F of z is constant. Right. Now, from the first expression, what we have assumed is capital F of z as small f of z minus small f of A. Now, let me express small f of z just by shifting the term. So I'll get f of z plus f of A. Since A is an arbitrary point which is constant, so function of constant is again a constant, and what we have proved is f of z is constant. A is constant, function of a constant is constant. So this is a constant and this is a constant. We have expressed it as a sum of constant. So RHS part is constant, thereby I can say LHS, that is f of z, is also constant. So that is what we require to prove, is f of z is constant. Fine. So this is the first corollary of a theorem. So here is the second corollary. A statement is if f of z and g of z is analytical in region D, here we have two functions. If f of z is equal to g of z, given that those two functions are equal, holds in an open set U subset of D, then that is U is subset of a D. D is a region and U is subset which is inside a D. Then we have to prove that f of z is equal to g of z, given they are both are analytical function. So here also let us define a function f of z as small f of z minus g of z, as we are define this same function in a first corollary as well. Since given that f of z and g of z is analytical, so if both are analytical, meaning is difference is also analytical function, in the sense both the values in right hand side is analytical, thereby I can say f of z is analytical. See, in the notes all these steps are not explained clearly, where you are getting confusion. So please go through this video, then you can understand clearly. Fine. So f of z is analytical in the region D. Now what is the given data? U is a open set in D. So U is an open set in D. So as per the definition of open set, there exists a K which is neighborhood of A. I'll just write here, which is neighborhood of A, such that K will be subset of U, subset of D. This is the definition of open set. You have already studied this in topology. Then we can write f of z is equal to small f of z minus g of z is equal to 0. Fine. In open set, this value will be equal to 0. Thereby, I can write f of z is also equal to 0 in region K, that is K is subset of D. Fine. So by the Abbot theorem, in the sense what we have proved in the Abbot theorem, if f of z is equal to 0, then this neighborhood function value is also equal to 0. That is f of z minus g of z will be equal to 0. Meaning is f of z is equal to, it is g of z. This value is g of z. So f of z is equal to g of z. And this is what we required to prove is. So corollary is quite simple, you can prove, but it was asked in one of the year, I don't remember the year exactly. So this is the second corollary. So here is the third corollary. If f of z is analytical in a region D and f of z is not equal to 0 in D, then if a is a 0 of f of z, so it is clearly given that it is a 0 in the sense f of a is equal to 0. There exists a positive integer in N and analytical function g in D such that f of z is equal to z minus a power of n into g of z, where g of a is not equal to 0. So we can prove this theorem easily by using Taylor series expansion. First, let me write down the given condition that f of z is analytical. Whatever the statements is there, I'll just skip. I'll send you the notes. So I'll just explain the concept. So let f of z be analytical function in the region, and moreover it is not equal to 0 in D. Fine. Then by the principle of analytical continuation, there exists a positive integer n such that f power of n of a is not equal to 0. So if f of z is analytical in a region which is not equal to 0, then this condition is true by principle of analytical continuation. Now let us define a function g of z in such a way that g of z is equal to f of z divided by z minus a power of n. Fine, where z should not be equal to 0. If it is equal to 0, this goes to infinity. Clear? And g of a will be equal to f power of n of a divided by n factorial. Let me call this as equation 3. Why? Because when you replace the z with a, this term will not be there. So that is why I have represented this function as this. So let us define g of a as this. Now, since nth derivative of a is not equal to 0, that is f power of n of a should not be equal to 0 as per the principle of analytical continuation, then this implies that g of a is also not equal to 0. If this term is not equal to 0, this will never be equal to 0, right? Then let us consider a Taylor series expansion of f of z, expansion of a function f of z in the neighborhood of a point a. Fine, I have already done this theorem. So what it says, f of z can be expressed as n is equal to 0 to infinity f power of n of a by n factorial into z minus a power of n. That is, I'll just expand this. F of z is equal to, about the point n is equal to 0, right? F of 0 plus f dash of a into z minus a plus f double dash of a divided by 2 factorial into z minus a square, so on. So if you keep on expanding, you will get f power of n minus 1 of a divided by n minus 1 factorial into z minus a power of n minus 1. I am just expanding and generalizing it. So f power of n of a divided by n factorial into z minus a power of n plus f power of n plus 1 of a divided by n plus 1 factorial into z minus a power of n plus 1. So this is by Taylor series expansion. I have written it for n plus 1 terms. So let us call this as equation 4. Fine. Now let us extract the value of f of a. So f of a, in the sense wherever z is there, you just replace it with a. So you are going to get f of a as f dash of a. Or else let me do this. Since f of a value, I'll just do it directly. Since f of a value will be equal to f dash of a, will be equal to f double dash of a, again it will be equal to f power of n minus 1 of a. So let me substitute these values as 0 in equation 4. What I have done is I have expanded it by using Taylor series expansion, and I'm going to remove all the derivative by substituting the derivative values as 0. So if you do that, equation 4 becomes, so if you replace all these values, then equation 4 can be written as f of z is equal to, f of 0 will not be there, so this values is also not be there. You will get only nth terms, nth order derivatives you will get. So f power of n of a divided by n factorial into z minus a power of n plus f of n plus 1 of a divided by n plus 1 factorial into z minus a power of n plus 1, so on. Let me call this as equation 5. What I have done is I have equated only the derivatives up to n minus 1 as 0. So up to the term start with here to here goes to 0. So only left term is this with this term, and n plus 1 terms will be continuing there. Fine. Now what I'm going to do is I'll just rewrite this f of z is equal to this expression. Now I'll substitute this equation 5 in equation 2. So here we have an equation 2. So I can write this as g of z is equal to f of z by z minus a power of n, right? So when you substitute, you will get f power of n of a divided by n factorial plus f power of n plus 1 divided by n plus 1 factorial of a into z minus a plus f of a power of n plus 2 into z minus a whole square divided by n plus 2 factorial plus so on. Let me call this as equation 6. What I have done is I have replaced f of z value here. So I have divided it with z minus a power of n. So when you divide z minus a power of n, z minus a power of n cancelled in first term. In the second term, z minus a one term cancelled, you will get power n here. That is, I have expanded for 1, 2 and so on. So that in the last, you will be having nth term. So this is what I have. Now what I'm going to do is, I'll just multiply it with z minus a. Multiply with z minus a on both sides. So you will get g of z into z minus a is equal to f power of n of a by n factorial into z minus a plus f power of n plus 1 of a divided by n plus 1 factorial into z minus a is z minus whole square plus this term will be continuing as it is. So meaning of this expression is, as limit a tending to or z tending to a, z minus a into g of z will be equal to what? See here, z tending to a in the sense, replace z with a. So a minus a is 0. Again a minus a is 0. 0 into any term will be 0. So this entire expression goes to 0. Meaning is that whenever you are substituting the point z is equal to a, all the terms of principal values getting eliminated. Right? Meaning is g of z is removable singularity. Removable singularity at z is equal to a. Clear? So what in the next session I'll be explaining the concept of removable singularity. So all these singularity concept, you have very important theorem based on the same concept. Anyhow, we are making use of the glimpses of those concept here. Fine. So meaning of existence of singularity, removable singularity, is that as per the definition of removable singularity, I can write f of z is equal to z minus a power of n into g of z. This is the standard definition of removable singularity is. Anyhow, I'll explain the singularity concept in the next session, but we are making use of the concept of removable singularity. So whenever this condition satisfies, we say it is removable singular. So as per the definition of removable singularity, we can write this, and this is what we require to prove is. So hope so this is clear. This is the third corollary. So it is also important. In the next session, I'll start with the very important concept called singularity. Singularity and types of singularity, there you are going to study removable singularity as well. Thank you. Continue in the next session.